All right, let's dive in into the topic of logistic regression by viewing it as a single layer neural network. And yeah, this is why I emphasized the identity function in Adeline so much, because if we look at this figure here, this is a single layer neural network where we have the inputs x, the weights w, and then we compute the net input here and the activation here. And then an output here where we, for example, could apply a threshold function. But for training, we can ignore the threshold function. For training, we usually use the output from the activation. So in Adeline, this activation function was an identity function. So this was in Adeline. And in Adeline, then we used the mean squared error as a loss function between, we computed it between the activation and the true class labels. So here A, this is the activation here, and then we had some true class labels Y and computed the mean squared error. Now, the only difference really between Adeline and logistic regression is that we have a different activation function. So one difference is that we now use this logistic sigmoid function instead of the identity function. So in Adeline again, we had just the identity function Z, so input Z, output Z. Now we have this nonlinear function. So this is a nonlinear activation function. I will show you in the next slides how it looks like. And another difference between logistic regression and Adeline is that we now have a different loss function. I will cover the loss function in logistic regression in the next video though, so that we can keep this video a little bit shorter. All right, so here is how the logistic sigmoid function looks like. So that's just from the previous slide. So what I showed you on the right-hand side is this one. I mean, there are two forms you can write it as. Usually, this one is the more common form in deep learning or in deep learning contexts. We will be using this activation function also in the context of multi-layer perceptrons later. So how you get from here to here, from the left-hand side to the right-hand side is just by dividing by e to the power of z. So if you divide this by e to the power of z, you get the right-hand side because, this would be 1, this would be 1, and this part will be e minus z, right? Because of this relationship. All right, so here's how it looks like. So we have the activation here plotted on the y-axis and the net input, which is passed to the activation function on the x-axis. So this is really the input to the activation function here. And you can see that it's centered around 0. So here it's centered around 0. And if the input is 0, then the output will be 0.5. And it saturates here at 1. So the maximum value is 1, so it approaches 1. And here, on the other hand, it approaches 0. So it's a function between 0 and 1. All right, so but you can see you have to have very negative or very positive values. So this is how this function looks like. So I will explain to you how the logistic regression loss function works like in the next video. Here I just wanted to summarize a few things, and it may be that you have to think a bit about this because it can look a little bit complicated at first glance, but essentially it's not that complicated. So let me just use this notation here to summarize the logistic regression model, where H, you can think of it as the hypothesis in traditional machine learning, or you can, more simple terms, think of it as the model. This is our logistic regression model, which receives as input the net input, and then you have this logistic sigmoid activation function that I showed you in the previous slide, which returns a value between 0 and 1. And you can actually think of this whole model here as a model that computes the posterior probability, the probability of class label y given a feature vector x. So y is the class label and x is the feature vector. So you can think of it as this. And now let's say we have We have class label 1. So let's look at a concrete example. Let's consider the iris dataset, where we have class label 1 as, let's say, Setosa. For a simplified scenario, think of it as a binary classification problem. We have 1 as Setosa and 0 as Versicolor, these two classes. Now, if I want to compute the probability that a given feature vector belongs to Setosa, to class 1, I can write it as this, p y equals, let's say 1 because it's shorter, given x, and this is computed as this one, and the probability of y equals 0 is computed as x, which we can write as 1 minus h of x. So these are the feature vectors here, these x's. Now, so imagine the probability for Setosa is 0.8, then equivalently the probability for Versicolor would be 0.2, right? So if this is indeed true. So if the flower is indeed Setosa, then this would be actually pretty good. So let's say we assume we have a true label. Let's assume the true label is actually 1. Then it would be actually pretty good to get an accuracy of 80%. The higher the better, though, so we want to actually have a high probability. But if the true label is 0, then a high probability would actually be bad. If the true label is 0, what we want is actually a high probability for PY, so I can just maybe use different color. What we want here is we want to have a high probability for this case then. If the true label is indeed 0, then we want to have a 80% maybe for this case. So that is what I'm summarizing here at the bottom of this slide. So if we have a binary classification problem with possible class labels 0 and 1, what we want is these probabilities to be close to 1 for the respective class. So if the class label, the true class label, is 0, then we want the probability for y equals 0 to be close to 1. If the true label is 1, then we want the probability for this scenario to be close to 1. So in this case, it's depending which probability we want to be maximized depends on the true label here. So we will look at that, how we can do that with a loss function in the next video. But this is like the basic setup. So we want a high probability given the certain class. So vice versa, we can also think of it like this. If we have a Setosa label, we want this one to be large, which gives us the scenario for class 1. So if we have a Setosa case, make this one large, make this one small. However, let me erase that because we don't have that much space. If we have a true label, Versicolor, then make this one small and make this one large. So this is essentially what we want to achieve, and I will show you how we can do that in the next video.